Thank you very much for the kind invitation. And first of all, I apologize for not being with you in person in Budapest. But you know, Vienna and Budapest, we are so close, we can even communicate via Skype. I understand that I am following George Schöpflin. And I guess you got quite a pessimistic picture of Europe. I can see from your faces that I am right or not totally wrong. But George Schöpflin is certainly a good friend. I know him from London. I was invited to talk to you about what lies beyond the crisis. And the question is, does Europe have chances in a new era of geopolitics? And this demands, first of all, an explanation of what I'm talking about. First of all, do we have a crisis in the European project? And I guess you got from the previous speaker an idea that we do have a crisis. And I think it's a very deep crisis of the future of the integration project. You know all the examples that we have in hand. Most of them have to do with foreign policy. Just look at the issue of the Turkish invasion of northern Syria, where it was not possible to have a common position of the EU member states. I'm not mentioning which country opposed the common statement, but I think you know who that was, which country that was. Or just think about the promise we made to North Macedonia and we made to Albania, which was not fulfilled at the last council, and it was postponed possibly to the next meeting in Croatia, but we don't know whether that's true. I just had an hour ago a meeting with friends from the Netherlands, and I had no chance to convince them why the integration of the Balkan countries is important for the, not only for this country, but for the European integration project. So the crisis is obvious, and one could add to this the whole Brexit dilemma and what the consequences for the European Union will be. And the fact simply that we, 27, are complaining about possible trade problems that we will have on day one, but we are not discussing what it means for our project overall. Sometimes we agree that we should discuss the consequences for the budget of the European Union, but this again is another example of a crisis, because I can assume that for the next 1 or 2 years, most European discussions in the European Union will be led along the lines of who is a NATO payer and who is a NATO receiver in the European Union. And this is actually the wrong question. And one of the points I would like to mention here is the fact that we have to look to overcome the European crisis for exactly those fault lines that we have and how we can work beyond these fault lines. The example of the discussions of the budget for the next years in the European Union has started already. On the one side, with meetings of those who are NATO payers, there is a group which includes Austria, I have to say, and on the other hand, of those 11 or more who are receiving money. So we should, as soon as possible, try to find formats where we cross this fault line of the budget issue. So this is, the crisis is there. I don't have to analyze more of that. I think we may all agree on this. And the second proposition I have is geopolitics. My simple assessment is that the time we are in is a time of return of geopolitics. And to a certain extent, we are not prepared, and it's unexpected. It is an unexpected consequence of globalization processes after the end of the Cold War. And when we look back now, 30 years after the end of the Cold War, one might say, why didn't we understand what it means also for Europe? Because it was clear that there was a fragmentation of all sorts of loyalties, of all sorts of identities, which is a consequence of globalization and the uniformation which comes with it. We could have read books like Huntington's books, not so much as an idea of how religion may in the future be important, but actually about how the idea what identities are built upon has to be discussed anew. And this is one of the discussions that you are leading in Hungary. These are discussions we're leading in a lot of Europeans and also non-European countries. And with that, the globalization process also comes the idea, what does power in the future mean? And do we have a chance to keep up the liberal international system that we have as a multilateral order in the world? And it is, to my mind, very obvious that it was not the small countries which started to challenge this system, but it was, and I have to mention once again, I think, or not for the first time tonight, the name of Donald Trump, who yesterday made it public that the US will not continue in the climate agreement, climate pact that we have. So challenging and leaving the international multilateral system is another obvious consequence of globalization. And so by this rapid return of the idea of geopolitics, we Europeans have to take into account a few things, maybe more than other parts of the world. And my first point is, as I already mentioned, the disruption of multilateral structures and instruments. How should we react in Europe? So what is after the crisis in this context? Some countries in Europe say we should simply defend the multilateral system because it is important that we keep it. Others, and I think there is more reason following them, is saying that what we need, and this is only a slogan so far, we need a more effective multilateral system. You might ask, what does it mean, more effective? Does it mean more geopolitical? Does it mean fairer? So there are various options to be discussed by making the multilateral system more effective. I give you one example where it's very obvious that the system is not truly working. This is the question, for instance, of the Human Rights Council in Geneva. It is not understandable why in a fair system, a country like Israel should be many more times be affected by comments from the council than the rest of the Arab world, for instance. So there seems to be something wrong in the way our multilateral instruments make it possible to create some sort of open dialogue and of real discussions about our multilateral structures. And the consequence is that the disruption can take place and countries leaving UNESCO, for instance, are not a good sign, because if there is even a tendency to leave the cultural and educational organization of the United Nations, it is not a good omen for the future of our multilateral system. What is the consequence of this? Also seen from a geopolitical point of view, it looks as if there is a constant search, and this must include also Europe, what will the balance of power be after the end of the Cold War, after the crisis of 28 and 29, so the financial crisis. So who are the players who can create the new balance? And it looks as if, and there I'm very cautious not to be too direct, that the response that some of our smaller countries, also European countries, are following is that we need to go back a little bit more to national identity issues, to more identity politics on a national level. And I do understand why especially countries, for instance, Visegrad countries with the experience, historical experience they have, they want to prove how important the national narrative is for creating a common identity. But what is the consequence? First of all, the consequence is that in countries like Hungary, Poland, but also Romania, you have a polarization of the society. I don't have to tell to a mainly Hungarian audience what the consequence for the existence of a common feeling about Hungarian identity is, and how much the political powers in a country like Hungary look to be separated, and even the remembrance of important date in your own national history cannot be celebrated together, but they're done in a separate way. I experienced that, for instance, in Poland on many occasions. But what the result of such a discussion about the return of more national narratives is that the big powers will get more power by doing so. And we should be aware in the smaller countries that we are doing the job of the big powers who want to create the balance of power politics, which reminds me to a certain extent of Vienna, because it was the Congress of Vienna where there was this big power balance, and some people proudly say that it saved peace in Europe for 100 years. This may be the case, but we should at least discuss whether it's a good idea that by the political actions that we follow, mainly in Europe actually, we are helping and doing the job for the big countries who want to create a new multipolar world. The term multipolar world itself is something which, as you know, has been started to be brought in a political discussion by Russia. But it's now taken up by China, and even in American think tanks, some of them seem to be not too afraid to say we don't speak openly about U.S. dominance, but we could agree to a balance of power of big powers where we say, where we discuss issues on a between the two of us. A good example is, unfortunately, the ending or the danger of ending of multinational arms regulation treaties. And you know about the discussions about the INF and other treaties which come to a close. So the consequence of two strong national narratives between our small countries in Europe will lead, and this is my thesis, to a more great power politics in the end. And there we have to be careful. And the third point of the obvious return of geopolitics, which we should also take into consideration, is something which I guess we can all agree there is a significant return of the importance of geography, history, the issues of borders, the issues of center and periphery. And there I'm quite actually hopeful that this is a good chance for Europe when we realize what it means. Because it means that if a structure is no longer adequate, we find ways to arrange it according to the way we feel that history, geography, and ideas about separation of powers, but also of different strength of power, can be regulated. Good example, the separation of Czechoslovakia, which was done in a peaceful way, looks to me as if it was successful, although it was not very popular, and as you know, there was no referendum before it was done. It was simply the meeting of two people in Brno under a very nice Lindenbaum, I think it was. And I just recently invited them to Vienna to discuss it, and they were still both very proud of what they achieved. So this issue is not something which happened only immediately after the end of the Cold War, but it is a discussion nowadays. Just think about the issue of what does it mean, right of self-determination, be it the case of Scotland, be it the case of Catalonia. What does it mean that in the European Union we are still not agreed on the issue of Kosovo? There are still member countries which do not accept the sovereignty of Kosovo. Or think about plans on the Balkans to change borders between Kosovo and Serbia, which were rejected immediately by some countries. I'm not mentioning the names of these countries now, because they were afraid that the structures that we are so proud of include the idea of the inviolability of state borders. And I think when we look into European history, this has often been claimed. But in many cases, it was possible to find a solution to a conflict also by changing borders. I'm not promoting the idea, I'm just saying that we should not rule it out because of our traditional feeling that change of border is always dangerous, because we had a lot of change of borders, and in Europe when you look into the these issues, some of them even now play a role, because integration after change of borders in a political system is not easy. Some of the examples are still very relevant. In the Austrian case, we found a solution regarding the Burgenland, our youngest federal province, which used to belong to the Hungarian part of the monarchy, which looks to be integrated after almost 100 years. Next year, 2 years, it will be 100 years. But when you ask sociologists, you still find traits where it's very different in the social structure from the rest of Austria. One example is, for instance, a funny one, is that at no other federal province in Austria where so many people drive Mercedes cars than in Burgenland, which some interpret as an example of not being on the same social level as the rest of Austria. I'm sure you know all of examples like this in your own home countries where this still plays a role. We can say the change of borders is possible, and it is also possible to solve problems of ethnicity sometimes. I'm mentioning just the case of Poland after the Second World War, but there are many more examples where this has to be discussed. So the issue of geography and the significance of borders, history and geography, is certainly part of this new geopolitical thing that we have. And I think for Europe to have a chance, we have to be quite open-minded on this, because this is not something we can talk away. It is part of legitimizing political power. It is part of the political discourse which is used by ruling parties, but also sometimes by opposition parties to find a solution in this situation. What is more important is this idea of centers and periphery, which in discourse now you have in the political life means more or less that you have areas where power is concentrated and areas which have to be civilized. And if you look a little bit into our discussions of the last 30 years after the end of Cold War, you do understand that this is still something which resonates with people. When I go to Poland, but also to other parts of the former Comecon and Warsaw Pact countries, you have the feeling that people feel that they are second-class EU citizens. And we should not underestimate this certainly emotional aspect of what it means where the center lies and where the periphery lies. Again, we in Austria and Vienna, we have some experience because we were used to be the center, at least of the Central European world, for quite a long time. After 1918, we were quite the peripheral capital of a small republic. And after 1938, we were one of many German cities, which was certainly not in the center of what was going on. So this experience that a lot of European parts also politically have with being either center or periphery is something which is useful, and I think more helpful than the victim's discourse, which you also can find in various parts of Europe. And here I have to mention that also in the Hungarian political context, the victim's discourse, the idea even of being a double victim of history is something which is back on the political stage. I would agree that Hungary and other countries were victims in the Nazi time and in the Soviet time, but now using it also by referring to being a victim to Brussels is something where I think we are not creating chances for a common Europe, but rather more problems. So this actually leads to the whole idea of why is identity politics so strong again? When you see at the results of elections in many of European countries and also in the election result in the United States of America, so this idea of America first, Austria first, even Europe first, is something which is understandable for as an instrument for political life, but it does not help us in creating chances in an age of geopolitics, because you have two options. Either you say we have a lot of strong nation states which compete in trade areas, like the British were hopeful to be able to do. I'm not so sure how successful they will be with their trade treaties, what I hear from Mr. Trump and others, or even from Modi in India, who almost made fun already of the British getting a better trade deal than they got in the European Union. So there is this idea that it will not help you on the side of economics or in trade policy. And on the other side, there is the issue that it doesn't also help you finally to create a Europe which can play a role on this global market, on this big power market which exists. So all I said so far was saying that Europe should be more realistic in this new age, and it should accept that on the one hand, the players will be the big ones, and we have to look what are the ways that we in the European Union and in a wider Europe can be part of this game, or whether we are not at the table but on the table, to be very, very frank and very clear.